It's a typical day in Dog Patch USA, where typical folks do things in a typical way. First we rub the sleep from our eyes, get our grub and shoo away the flies. We spend what's negotiable, then we get sociable, sitting around swapping lies.
And then we drop by to collect unemployment pay,
which leads us to say it's a typical day in Dog Patch USA.
To change a gal's title to Mrs. or even Madame. For 15 cents extra, I'll furnish the bride's bouquet.
Step aside for Earthquake Magoo. Busting out all over like Jewel. I stands on the corner, enormous and ornery, making the fairer sex swoon. My secret desire's to tangle with Daisy May.
Like he said, my name's Daisy May, 'cause my mom, she planned it that way. My one aim in life is to be a good wife and to marry Li'l Abner someday.
She chased Li'l Abner clear off into outer space. If he could be caught in the next Sadie Hawkins race.
Mammy here, society's queen, and she heads the local machine.
Ah, sweet but osmistical and pugilistical, matter of fact, a champion.
Li'l Abner, we has both learned, still don't know how money gets earned.
He's big and he's gentle,
but unsentimental as far as young gals is concerned.
I get pretty tired of running from Daisy May,
which leads us to say it's a typical day in Dog Patch USA.
Marin Sam.
Good old dog.
Hi, Marin Sam.
Back.
Welcome
greetings, everybody.
Sam,
greetings to y'all.
Hi
there.
Mary and Sam.
Hi, Sam.
Hi.
Howdy, Mary and Sam. Welcome home.
Well, it sure is nice to see all you gals getting in shape for the big race next Friday.
We sure is, Sam.
Has you any new types of weddings for us this year, Sam?
No, honey, just my usual line. There's my $2 standard, which guarantees you 3 weeks of bliss and 50 years of quiet desperation. My $4 special, my $6 foreign sports model. That's in case any of you latches onto some foreign sports. And, of course, my $8 spectacular. And don't you worry none about your credit, because this year I'm on the Diners Club.
Now, we'll see you next Friday, Sam, with our newly intended, whoever they may be.
Grab yourself a live one, Moonbeam.
We sure will, Sam. See ya.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten.
Come on, Sophia. Let's go see our friend, Available Jones.
Well, howdy, Sam. Welcome home.
Howdy, Available. My show is good to see, and it's good to be back here in the metropolis. I guess that's where I belong.
You always was a city boy at heart.
Yeah, I likes to hustle and to bustle and... Say, what you working on?
Greatest piece of merchandise I ever had for the Sadie Hawkins Day race. It's my ICBM.
ICBM? What's that mean?
I catch his bachelor man.
Sounds promising. How does it work?
Top secret. Already been promised to a matriarchal head of one of Dogpatch's first families.
Not Pansy Yoakum.
No comment.
Now, don't tell me that Mammy's fixing to trap Li'l Abner so's Daisy May can catch him this year.
Can't discuss it.
Why not?
You knows my integrity, my sense of honor. When I makes a confidential deal for a price, my lips is sealed and they stay sealed.
Till you gets a better price.
Naturally.
Man, Sam. Man, Sam.
What is it, Luella?
Mammy Yoakum says for you to come right on over for a business conference of enormous magnitude.
I'll be right there, child. Oh, by the way, how's your dear mother?
She's out a hunting.
And your dear father?
That's what she's a hunting for.
Lovely child. Think there's a chance we can marry her off this year?
So is. Soon as her divorce is final.
Keep me informed.
Abner, it's time to go fishing.
I'm coming.
You can't go yet.
Why not?
Because you can't, that's why.
But Pansy, if the boy wants to go fishing.
Hush up, you can't go yet.
But why not?
Because you haven't taken your yokenberry tonic.
Mammy, I'm too old to still take that old baby tonic.
Oh, no, you ain't.
Oh, yes, I is.
Oh, no, you ain't, and I knows best. I've been giving you a spoonful of my own special yokenberry tonic every day since the day you was born, and I intends to give you a spoonful every day to the day you dies, and for several weeks thereafter. Now, open and hold.
But, Mammy,
open and hold, I have spoken.
Hey, Abner. Come on.
I'm coming.
Abner Yoakum, you sit that down right there.
Huh?
That there.
Oh, Mammy.
Now, Abner, Daisy May's coming by soon. So's Mary and Sam. And I kind of thought that maybe this year you'd let that sweet little gal catch on Sadie Hawkins' day.
Pansy, if the boy feels he ain't ready for marriage yet...
Happy, why don't you take your oversized nose and your undersized self and take a walk?
No, Pansy.
Go on, stroll into town. See what's doing down in the lower rent district. Go on, Dick.
But Pansy...
Dick, I have spoken.
One of these days, you're gonna make me very mad. Get out of my way.
Now, son.
Mammy, before you get started, I got something to say. You is my very own mother. Down deep inside of me, I loves and respects you. Almost as much as I loves and respects the U.S. of A. But I also want to say that down deep inside of me, I loves and respects fishing. And that's where I'm going now.
But Abner, I...
See you later, Mammy.
Abner, I'm...
Now, you wait right here for me, Sophia, and don't you go chomping on any of them yokenberries.
Well, howdy, Sam.
Why, howdy, Pansy Yoakum. Sure is nice to see your yokenberry tree blooming so high and happy.
Does pretty well every year, Sam, thank you.
Yes, and how is your sweet, gentle, and relentless little self?
Tolerable, Sam, tolerable. But I has to have a man-to-man talk with you.
Summit conference?
The summitest. Sit down, Sam. Tell me, Sam, what you got this year in a $2 wedding?
My $2 wedding? This year it is spectacular. First, I strips to the waist and wrestles of four biggest guests, male or female.
That's a nice warm beginning.
Then I tells four or five off-color stories guaranteed to embarrass man or beast. And as I ties my arms and legs to four infuriated mules...
Mammy, you'll come. Mammy. Mammy, look at this. Oh, hello, Mary and Sam.
Morning, Daisy, and how's your sweet and well-proportioned little self?
Miserable, Sam. Look what I just received, a wedding invite.
Well, what's so miserable about that?
It's an invite to my own wedding.
What?
Listen to this. Dear madam, you was hereby cordially invited to attend the nuptials of your own sweet, well-put-together self and that ever-popular champion dirty wrestler of the world, namely me, Earthquake Magoon.
Earthquake Magoon?
Dinner, RSVP.
What's that mean?
When you has dinner with Earthquake Magoon, RSVP means only one thing. Roast skunk, very possible.
Mammy, I'm scared. I never said I'd nuptialize with a miserable ape like Earthquake Magoon.
Did I hear my name? Morning, ladies. Howdy, Sam. My, Daisy May, you looking special pretty this morning.
Thank you, Mr. Magoon.
Glad I ran into you, Sam. Tell me, what has you in a $4 wedding?
And just what, may I ask, would a rat varmint like you want with information about a $4 wedding?
Could be. I'm fixing to get myself married. Since just returning home with my newly acquired title, namely the world's dirtiest wrestler, I am particularly well-heeled.
Is you inferring you has money?
Lady, I is filthy with it.
Mister, you was filthy without it.
Naturally, I intend to wed a certain dog patch gal.
Magoon, you crazy or something?
You knows a man can't claim a gal for marriage down here less than she catches him herself on Sadie Hawkins Day.
If and you want the answers, I suggest you perambulates on down to the Fogbaugh meeting, which is about to be held at Cornpone Square.
Cornpone Square? You mean this is going to be a Cornpone meeting?
By direct request of my very good friend, the Honorable Senator Jack S. Fogbaugh.
Is Senator Fogbaugh coming here?
That's right. First time in 18 years.
This could be serious.
And we only has cornpone meetings for events of national importance.
Or a hideous change in the dog patch way of life.
They're gonna be a hideous change, all right. Come on, Sam. Now tell me about your $8 wedding.
Well, I don't crave your business, but I can't discriminate. Now, first, I clips your toenails, gives you a quick shave and a sponge bath if and you needs it. And, frankly, I'd say you needs it.
I like that for a beginning.
Looks bad, Daisy.
Oh, what is we gonna do?
I'll tell you what we's gonna do. You hightail it up to Polecat Creek and tell Abner and the rest of them no-good skunks to get over there to that meeting.
Right. But what if they'd druther not?
Well, you just tell them that I'd druther, they'd druther. And when Panzer Yoakum says she'd druther, they'd druther.
Druther, they'd druther.
If I had my druthers, I'd druther have my druthers than do any work at all. It ain't that I hates it, I often contemplates it while watching the raindrops fall. I sits there for hours, developing my powers, of figuring how flowers gets tall. If I had my druthers, I'd druther have my druthers than do any work at all.
Abner? Oh, there you are. Abner? Abner, Mammy says you all's to come to the meeting.
Daisy May, you's out of bounds.
Abner, you...
You know Polecat Creek is off limits to love starved females.
I know.
And since you was both love starved and female, I suggest you get out the way you got in.
Abner Yoakum, if and you don't get down to that meeting, Mammy gonna give you what for?
What for is she gonna give me what for?
Because it's a big, important meeting. Big enough so that Earthquake Magoon's gone around bragging how he's gonna marry me and throw me a big fancy wedding with a roast skunk dinner.
That's just talk. He can't marry you unless and you catches him first on Sadie Hawkins Day. And you don't run after nobody but me. You does it every year, you po-so.
This year it'd be so simple if and you just helped me. I mean, if you was ashamed, I could dig a big hole and you could fall in and pretend like you broke your leg. Or maybe I could shoot you in some unimportant place.
Daisy May, that is subversive talk, and I won't hear none of it.
Abner.
And neither will these boys. Now, you get on out of here.
But, Abner.
I said get.
But Mammy said...
Get, I have spoken.
All right, I'll just tell Mammy you ain't coming to the cornpone meeting.
Cornpone meeting?
Of course.
You didn't say it was a cornpone meeting.
But...
Did you hear that, fellas? A cornpone meeting. This must be a national emergency. We better get down there fast as my call for some brains or something.
Come on.
Daisy, fetch me my worms.
Surely. Oh.
Bad on me. Time's a wasting, so let's get on with the meeting.
Yeah, man, later.
Fellow citizens, I, my honor, Daniel D. Dogmeat, declares open this solemn jubilation tea corn pone meet.
Well, that's fine. I'm sure
who was jubilation tea corn pone?
Hush up, I said.
Now, wait a minute, Roof. Don't whomp that child. Come here, Zsa Zsa. Zsa Zsa, honey, it's high time you knew that our town was founded by that beloved man a setting up there on that beloved horse, jubilation tea corn pone. Greatest fighting general, a military strategist, a Confederacy ever knew.
Was he brave?
Brave? Why, J.T. Cornpone didn't know the meaning of the word fear. Terror, yes, but fear never. And all over the countryside, there's monuments commemorating the names of his famous battles.
Such as?
Cornpone's disaster, Cornpone's misjudgment, Cornpone's catastrophe, and Cornpone's humiliation. When we fought the Yankees and the annihilation was near, who was there to lead the charge that took us safe to the rear? Why, it was Jubilation T. Cornpone. Old toot your own horn, Pone. Jubilation T. Cornpone, a man who knew no fear.
Tell us more, Sam.
Yeah, tell us. What else did he do?
When we almost had him, but the issue still was in doubt. Who suggested the retreat that turned it into a rout? Why, it was
Jubilation T. Cornpone.
He wrecked old tattered and torn Pone.
Jubilation T. Cornpone, he kept us hiding out.
With our ammunition gone and faced with utter defeat, who was it that burned the crops and left us nothing to eat?
Why, it was Jubilation T. Cornpone.
Old September morn Pone.
Jubilation T. Cornpone,
the pants blown off his seat.
Hooray!
When it seemed like our brave boys might keep on fighting for months, who took pity on them and capitulated at once?
Why, it was Jubilation T. Cornpone.
Unshaven and shorn Pone.
Jubilation T. Cornpone.
He weren't nobody's dunce.
Why, it was Jubilation T. Cornpone.
Unshaven and shorn Pone.
Jubilation T. Cornpone. He weren't nobody's dunce.
History says that General Grant was pretty good with a jug. Who drank drink for drink with him and wound up under the rug?
Why, it was Jubilation T. Cornpone.
Passed out until morn Pone.
Jubilation T. Cornpone. His whiskers in his mug.
Hearing that a northern spy had come to town for a night, who gained entrance to her rooms and lost a glorious fight?
Why, it was Jubilation T. Cornpone.
Old weary and worn Pone.
Jubilation T. Cornpone.
He fought all through the night. At Appomattox, Lee and Grant were present, of course. As Lee swept a tear away, who swept the back of his horse?
Why, it was Jubilation T. Cornpone. What's our forlorn Pone? Jubilation T. Cornpone. A picture of remorse. Why, it was Jubilation T. Cornpone.
Get onto your agenda.
Yeah, let's do a little agendizing.
All right, let's get back to the meeting. Now, the first thing on the agenda is...
Hold it! Hold it a minute!
Mayor Dogmeat, I got a question. I want to know is how come we having a corn pone meeting?
Hey, Abner, my boy, the answer to that is a coming up the road right now.
Hello, everybody! Hello, hello! Glad to see you. Well, now, say hello. Hello, yes. An earthquake, however, boy.
Howdy, Senator.
Abner, get back here.
Daisy, man. Wow.
Citizens of Dogpatch, our distinguished senator, the Honorable Jack S. Fogbound. Mayor Dogmeat and my beloved constituents of Dogpatch, I could stand here and bask in the sunshine of your warm greeting forever.
Bask on your own time, Fogbound.
Yeah, get to the point. Get to the point.
I bet you all wonder what I've been doing down in Washington these last 18 years.
We didn't care just so long as you was there and we was here.
Why? Senator, tell them what you done for us down there in Washington.
I done got the United States Senate to pass the Jack S. Fogbound bill. Hey!
There's no jackass like our jackass.
That's right.
Through my efforts, little old Dogpatch, obscure, unknown, poverty-stricken Dogpatch is going to be world famous.
And just what foe is we going to be famous for? What foe?
You is going to save the lifeblood of a vigorous, thriving American industry. That's what for.
And what industry is that, Senator?
My boy, a glorious young industry devoted solely to the stimulation and relaxation so necessary for the American businessman. An industry known as Las Vegas?
Las Vegas?
Ain't that where they do all that gambling?
Yes, sir, Daisy May. And right there's their problem. You see, in the desert nearby, the governments are shooting off certain nuclear weapons of war.
Atom bombs.
Atom bombs?
That's right. And atomic dust of them bombs is a-floating down and a-settling in them Las Vegas swimming pools and on them beautiful Greenfelt crap-shooting tables.
Well, that's a shame.
That Greenfelt is a-turning so brown, you can't tell them all whether your money is playing the field or coming the hard way.
Well, I object.
And the colors is fading on them slot machines?
No.
Oh, yes, they is. Why, you can't tell them all whether you got two cherries or three plums, three bells or two oranges. And when you hits the jackpot, you don't dare touch your money, because it might be radioactive. Does you think your government up there in Washington is going to stand by and let a tragedy like this happen to an American industry to whom so many have given so much for so little?
No!
No, my fool, no, my friends. And that is why the Jack S. Fogbound Committee has been chosen.
To find a new place to test them atom bombs and guided missiles?
Yes, sir. Some place we can blow off the face of the earth. Some spot that ain't never going to be missed. In fact, the most unnecessary place in the whole USA.
Well, I'll be dogged. How about that?
And I now has the honor and the privilege of announcing that after a 4-year government survey of all the no good, no account, unnecessary places in this whole country, you has been selected as the most unnecessary of all. Pay attention, you lovable citizens. You all's going to be moved out of here by order of the United States government. And here's the fine government scientist who will supervise your evacuation. Citizens, meet Dr. Rasmussen T. Finsdale.
Friends, we intend to move you from Dogpatch to a necessary place in our society. Now, the first detonation will be on Wednesday. But the evacuation will start immediately, so good luck and thank you.
And so, my dear constituents, as I bid you farewell, I beg you, don't let me down. Just remember, your government is spending $1 million on one bomb just to blow your homes off the face of the earth. also show your appreciation.
Don't cut, take a rag off of the pole. Don't cut, take a tassel off of the pole.
Of all the very ordinary, most unloved, unnecessary places on this earth, they send on yours. They send on yours. As sure as you're born. They send on occasion by making a history-creating romantic announcement. I hereby claims as my bride in marriage none other than that attractive little crowd pleaser, the ever popular Miss Daisy May.
Holy mackerel.
How dare you? Abner, give him what for?
I'll bust his head wide open.
Just a minute. Five does a head busting for this family. Magoon, you crazy. You know you can't claim no gal down here unless she catches you on Sadie Hawkins' day.
You hear the man? He say they gonna drop the bomb on Wednesday. Well, Sadie Hawkins' day ain't till Friday, so there can't be no more Sadie Hawkins' day.
No more Sadie Hawkins' day? What is we gonna do?
Mammy, what is we gonna do?
Think fast, Mammy. My income depends on the outcome.
Don't worry, Sam.
Quiet, everybody. Since we ain't gonna have no more Sadie Hawkins Day, we automatically goes back to the code of the hill.
Whereby, if a male desires marriage with a female of the opposite sex, he can claim his beloved if and he gets approval of her next of kin. Right, Mad Dog Meat?
That's the law.
Therefore, I claims in marriage the aforementioned lusciously desirable, delicious, delectable, palpitatingly appetizing young morsel.
Is that a female or a breakfast food?
Yes, sir. Miss Daisy May.
Under the cold of the hills, is there any other claimants?
Excuse me.
Naturally.
Much obliged.
Well, if there isn't any other claimers, I's the war.
Wait! Daisy. Also claims the ever popular lady in question.
You done what?
I claims Daisy May.
For the purposes of marriage?
Well, whatever he's claiming her for, I'm claiming her for.
Abner, does you really mean it?
Sure, I means it.
Oh, Abner, dear.
Ow! All right, we has two claimers. Now, under the aforesaid code of the hills, whereas there's two claimers, the choice must be decided on by Daisy May's next of kin.
Been decided?
What?
She already been promised to me by my good friend and Daisy May's closest next of kin, the ever sensible Romeo Scrag.
Romeo Scrag?
That's me, big and brassy, fat and sassy, fit as a fiddle and ready for love.
Romeo Scrag, you claims you Daisy May's kith and kin?
I is, and that's the whole trouble.
Trouble?
I'd like to kiss her, but I don't think I can.
Why now? Now, Daisy May, is Romeo Scrag your kinfolk or ain't he?
Well, yes, but they from a disgusting side of the family we never socializes with, excepting for weddings and hangings, mostly theirs.
Ain't no use you fighting it, honey child. You're pure Scrag from the top of your scraggy head to the bottom of your scraggy toes, and that's a mess of Scrag.
But we don't consider ourselves...
Once a Scrag, always a Scrag.
Fine, fine. Now, Romeo Scrag, is it true that you gave Daisy May to Earthquake Magoon?
Correct.
How could you make such a miserable decision?
Because Earthquake here, he's a fine man. He's a good man. He put love in his heart. He put faith in his country. And he just put $4 in my back pocket. Bless you, my children. Uh-uh. That'll be $4 more.
You let me at him!
Didn't I shoot you last week?
Did you hear what he said to me?
Quiet, everybody. Now let's get on with the plans for the evacuation.
Just a minute. R has something to say. Now, R has been promised to Earthquake Magoon to have and to hold.
I know some great holds.
He should
have gone.
And I'll go through with the nuptials fair and square, because we lives by the code of the hills, which I loves and respects. But first I want to ask a question. Is there a government man here?
Excuse me. Yes, miss? What is it?
Well, you're going to bomb our town because you couldn't find nothing about it necessary, right?
Correct.
Suppose we did find something necessary. What then?
Well, we'd hardly bomb any community which made a necessary contribution to society.
You all hear that? Now, I say let's go spread out and find something necessary.
She's right. We got to save our Sadie Hawkins Day, gals. We got to protect the rights of womanhood.
You can't stop your fellow citizens. They want to get up and get out of here. Yeah. These fine young maidens got a right to get out of this miserable pest hole and go see the outside world.
Yeah, yeah, Mammy. We wants to get citified.
Culturized.
Modernized. We wants to broaden our horizons.
So you does you? Well, let me tell you something. Your horizons are broad enough already. Especially yours. You gals got any idea what they got waiting for you out there? The horrible, miserable customs?
Like what?
Like a before marriage custom called engagement.
Engagement? What's that?
That's the time that elapses between when a gal says, shall do, and the preacher says, go to. Oh.
How long that engagement thing lasts?
Sometimes a whole month.
A whole month? What are they, insecure?
Yes, my good friends, you're going to have to do all kinds of horrible things out there. Going to have to take baths.
No.
Comb your hair.
No.
Cutting your nails.
No.
And worst of all, you're going to have to go to work.
No.
That's terrible. Is we going to stand for this injustice?
No.
Is we going to take this line down?
No.
Then what's we going to do? Oh, I'll tell you what we's going to do. We're going to turn this whole town upside down until someplace, somewhere, someone finds something necessary.
Daisy. Abner, let's stop and talk for a while.
This ain't no time to do any talking.
But Abner, don't you realize what you just done? You finally asked me to marry you.
Yeah, I know.
Why did you do it?
Well, I don't know. I just did, that's all.
But why?
Well, there you was, your usual sweet self. And there was old Earthquake, a panting, a puffing, a wheezing, and a snorting at you. And I'm gonna let no one like Magoon puff, pant, wheeze, and snort at you, you post soul, so I just ups and done it, that's all.
Does that mean you aims to let me catch you if we have Sadie Hawkins Day?
I reckon so.
Oh, Abner, what took you so long?
Well, I don't know, Daisy. Some years I wanted you to catch me awful bad, but I just couldn't. I don't know why I couldn't, but I couldn't.
They must have been a reason.
But what was it? Take last year's race, for instance. There I was, loping along with my usual burst of brilliant speed, and I turned around, seeing you sweet and pretty, reaching out your hand to grab me for life. And suddenly a voice inside of me hollered, Abner, boy, take off! And I took.
Oh, but that's all behind us now.
You really reckon?
And life's gonna be full of so many wonderful things. Things you've been deserving for such a long, long time.
Namely what?
You deserves a gal who's willing, namely me. One who'd love to have your chillin', namely me. Standing there in the doorway waiting at the close of day with you all the way to love, honor, and obey. You deserves two arms to hold you, namely mine, there to comfort and enfold you, rain or shine. I deserve someone strong and handsome, bashful and shy and true. And I know just the one who'll do, namely you.
You deserve someone good-looking, namely me. Someone who as yet ain't tooken, namely me. That is how I'll remain unless you get me, shall we say, in the family way. Come next Sadie Hawkins Day. You craves arms to make you tingle, namely mine. To a bachelor who's single, that sounds fine. Comes the day I no longer bachelor, naturally I'll be. And who could I be truest to? Namely, you.
Abner! Don't stand there mooning and spooning! Come on! We gotta get down and help save the town!
I'm sorry, it just won't do. There's nothing indispensable about any of this.
Here's something necessary.
Yeah, and what about this, Mr. Government Man?
No, there's absolutely nothing necessary about a cigar store Indian, or a set of his and her spittoons, or any of this trash. Is there anyone else?
I've got it! Here it is.
What is it?
A 1925 Sears Roebuck catalog, special dog patch edition.
But there's no printing in it. The pages are all blank.
Well, we didn't have any money that year, so they sent it out blank. Just to keep up the goodwill.
Well, it's interesting, my good man, but hardly a necessity.
Might be if you lived in Dog Patch.
No, I've had enough. This is an order. Every one of you pack your things. Government truck.
I got it. You can stop your fretting and your fussing, because I've really got it. The most necessary innovation in modern times.
Well, quickly, what is it?
Here, put these on. Cover up, young fella. Stupefying. Jones.
What does it do?
It's a deadly weapon. Guaranteed to stupefy any human male dead in his tracks. Here, I'll demonstrate. Hey, Itchy McRabbit.
Yeah?
Come on over here. All right, honey. 5, 4, 3, 2, blast off. Stupefied. Unstupefied.
What you want?
Nothing.
All right.
Well?
It's fascinating. But of what utility?
Why, she'd be invaluable to music lovers. She could make Elvis Presley stand still.
But I like him the way he is. Now then, enough of this nonsense.
I got it. I really got it. If he's looking for something necessary to the whole country, look no more, because I has it right here in this little bottle. My own special Yokenberry tonic.
Yokenberry tonic?
Yep. I wops it out of the berries of my yokenberry tree.
Mm-hmm. Madam, I never heard of a yokenberry tree.
Well, you wouldn't. There's only one of them in the whole world.
Mm-hmm.
That's right, and it's right in their front yard.
That's the truth.
Man ain't interested in your phony old tonic.
Phony? My boy Abner takes it, and just look at those muscles.
Yeah, just look at those muscles.
And look at that smile.
Wall-to-wall teeth.
I'm sorry, madam. We already have more tonics and bodybuilders than we can use.
Appears to me your body can still do with a little more building.
Now that's enough. The evacuation will proceed immediately.
Meaning there's just nothing about us that's necessary?
I'm afraid not. And I should think you'd be delighted at a chance to get out of a place like this.
You don't rightly understand, mister. It may not look like much to you, but this here's our land, our soil.
Where we was raised.
Where our kinfolk was born and hung.
Where our ancestors took their bare hands and built all of this out of the wilderness.
Our beautiful skunk works.
West Pork Chop Railroad.
That beautiful intersection of Hog Fat Boulevard and Sheep Dip Drive.
Where we was planning to build our new hotel, the Dog Patch Hilton.
Not to mention Conepone Square.
Come on, Mammy. Happy?
Kick'em, you looking for something really necessary? We got 'em.
Now what?
Kickapoo joy juice. Heap big fire water.
Cheap rot good. Ain't fit for human consumption.
Now wait. Can it be produced inexpensively?
Mister, if you pays more than a nickel a quart, you're violating the fair trade laws.
Well, there we are. An alcoholic beverage that could be sold to the American public for only 5 cents a quart. Perhaps I'd better taste it.
No need to bother, Doctor. I'd be glad to take a little taste for you.
Oh, very well, if you'd like.
Water!
Why bother with just plain water? Why not take something guaranteed to build you up? Like some Yokenberry tonic.
Mackley sure is.
What was in that bottle?
Just some of my own special bodybuilding tonic.
Has anyone ever taken this before?
No one in the whole world except my boy Abner.
And you say this tonic is made from a tree that grows only in your front yard?
That's right, and it belongs to my boy Abner.
Dr. Finsdale, this is a matter for top echelon security.
Right. Yoakum, you'll have to come to Washington immediately.
Yes, sir, Your Honor.
Now hear this, all of you. This Yokenberry tonic seems to have miracle-like properties, which could well alter our plan for the evacuation of Dogpatch. However, this drug will need exhaustive tests on human guinea pigs. And since you will be most affected by its outcome, I'm asking, are there any volunteers among you?
Hey, you got one right here. If he gonna come out looking anything like Abner, you got yourself one guinea pig.
If that stuff will make something like that out of something like this, you got him.
I'd be happy if mine had a pair of shoulders like that.
I'd be happy if mine had one shoulder like that.
Take him. Take them all.
Marion, Sam. Sam.
What is it, child?
Go along with him, Sam. Take care, Li'l Abner.
Be my pleasure, honey.
Gentlemen, you'll find an army truck waiting just down the road. Come along.
Hold on. Wait a minute. Mr. Scientist, does this mean we're going to be necessary after all?
My dear young lady, if these tests fulfill their promise, Dog Patch will not only become necessary, it will become absolutely indispensable.
The world was shaken to its roots today by a White House announcement that a Dog Patch lad named Abner Yoakum has discovered a miracle drug which may revolutionize mankind.
Was groznia zebratni Abner Yoakum. Porzna was dranka Dog Patch. As goi pas morska, Yoakum bere miracle drug. Koza prosmolja, we got it first.
Washington, the White House, Washington, D.C. Abner Yoakum has just told the president that if the Yoakum Berry tests are successful, he will give all rights of his fabulous drug to the government itself. Private industry is up in arms.
Fogbound, you idiot. Fogbound, you bumbling nincompoop. Didn't you tell Yoakum of my offer of $1 million for the rights to manufacture that drug?
I did, General Bullmoose, but he says he's only interested in what's good for the USA.
What's good for General Bullmoose is what's good for the USA. And by Dow Jones and all their little averages, don't you forget it. Right, boys?
Right. Three rousing rahs, a few huzzas, and a hip, 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 hooray. What's good for General Bull Moose is good for the USA.
Folk bound, I want the manufacturing rights to that drug. And by E.R. Squibbins' sons, I don't care how I get it. What's this nonsense about us wanting to give it away?
That's right. He's going to give it to the government.
Didn't you tell him I can make him a better deal than the government? I have more money and fewer dependents.
But my dear General Bull Moose...
Dear General Bull Moose me, you bumbling, incompetent hillbilly cretin. You realize what you've done? If I owned that tonic, I could make all the money in the world. And I need it. Ever since I was a little child, I had a dream. A simple child's dream. And all that simple child ever wanted was to get his hands on all the money in the world before the greatest broker of them all called him to that big stock market in the sky. And you, you imbecile, you shattered a little child's dream.
Bullsey!
Bullsey, sweet, lower your voice. You know what the doctor said. You mustn't get so excited. You'll lower your blood sugar.
I don't have blood sugar anymore. I sold it to my Cuban interests.
Oh, Bullsey.
Appassionata, you should have been here an hour ago. Why are you so late?
I had to make up.
Your face?
No, with the chauffeur. We had a little fight.
Oh. Remind me to fire that chauffeur. Now, Appassionata, that Yoakum Yokel is coming here today. He wants to give his drug to the government. And we've got to make him a better proposition. Now, let's see. What could we possibly offer him that he couldn't get from the government? Make sure I fire that chauffeur. Now, Appassionata, listen carefully. You've got to do everything you can to help. If this bumpkin gives his drug to the government, he threatens the whole free enterprise system.
What's in it for me?
This could destroy capitalism.
What's in it for me?
You've got to think of yourself as a super patriot doing a super patriotic duty.
What's in it for me?
$1 million.
Call me Betsy Ross.
Mr. Yoakum, to see you, sir.
Send him in, send him in. Keep your motor running, Appassionata. I may need you.
Come in, please. Just Mr. Yoakum.
Much obliged.
Well, well, well. My boy, my dear boy. I'm General Bullmoose, son.
Howdy, General.
You know the senator.
Oh, sure.
And this is Miss Appassionata von Climax, my executive secretary.
Howdy, ma'am. Executive secretary? What does that mean, Your Honor?
Well, she works here. She gets a salary. And she kind of lives in my house.
Oh. Does that mean you gets bed and board, ma'am?
Extremely.
Mighty pleased to meet you, ma'am.
Well, I'm mighty pleased to meet you, too, Mr. Yoakum.
Mighty pretty fur, ma'am. Did you shoot it?
No, I kind of trapped it.
Did you use any special bait?
Just inhaling and exhaling.
Yes, she's a very healthy girl. Yoakum, my boy, it's time you and I had a little business talk. Now, I'm offering you $1 million in cash for the rights to your drug.
But I already told the president.
President? What president?
President of the United States.
Oh, that president. Yoakum, I don't think you comprehend what this elixir of yours can do.
It stopped him from bombing my hometown, and that's all I cares about.
Idealistic nonsense. Yoakum, I have access to top-secret government reports, and so far the tests show this drug of yours exceeds the most fantastic discoveries of science.
Is that good?
Good! Why, it'll give every male a perfect physique. Makes fat men thin, thin men fat. Removes hair from where you don't want it. Puts to where it counts the most. Broadens your shoulders, narrows your hips. Builds up your corpuscles, lowers your blood pressure. Wakes you up in the morning, puts you to sleep at night. It softens your beard, toughens your skin, and what is more, it cleans your teeth and leaves your breath alone.
Show got good manners, don't it?
Yoakum, say the word and we're ready to go into production. We'll bottle it. We'll name it after you.
Me?
We'll call it, Yoca-Cola.
Yoca-Cola.
Son, we'll make billions. And for a starter, here's my check for $1 million.
Well, thanks, General. But if you don't mind, as a 100% red-blooded American, I'd rather give it to the United States government.
Government?
Yes, sir. Now, if you'll excuse me, I gotta catch my bus home. They're running Sadie Hawkins Day tomorrow, and this year I just can't miss it. I guess you knows why, Mr. Senator. Well, bye, Mr. General. Miss Executive, Senator.
But my boy, you can't walk out on $1 million.
Why not?
Well, because it's your... Well, it just isn't thrifty.
Well, maybe so, General. But I've always been kind of sporty with money. Bye, y'all.
Oh, Mr. Yoakum.
Yes, ma'am?
I do wish you'd stay.
Well, I have to catch a bus.
I'm sure you'd find it amusing.
Well, it's...
I could show you around the city, or maybe we could even go the country and do a little hunting.
Well, I have Sadie Hawk. Could we hunt skunk?
You do your skunk hunting in Dog Patch.
How to do, ma'am.
Oh, General, you better fire that chauffeur.
How do you like that? Well, I'm not through. Not yet. There's $1 billion in that drug, and I'm not selling short. Not by all the bearest bulls of all the bears and bulls on Broad Street. Fogbond, what's the Sadie Hawkins Day? Oh, a monstrous Dog Patch custom. Wherein the gals chases the men and marries whomsoever they catches. Can an outsider enter? Sure can. Then we got him. We go to Dog Patch. Passionata enters the Sadie Hawkins Day race. She runs the race. She catches Abner Yoakum. She marries Abner Yoakum. And by community property, she owns half of everything he owns, specifically Yoakumberry Tonic. Then, if some unfortunate accident should befall the poor fool, you, his young widow, would be the sole possessor of the entire drug.
But Bullsey, what if I don't catch him? I never run anymore.
You'll run this time or you'll be back wiping windshields at the 5-minute car wash. Don't bullsey me. Pat, get things a Passionata. We're heading south. We'll show these hillbillies what's what. Right, boys?
Right. He makes the rules and he intends to keep it that away. What's good for General Bull Moose is good for the USA.
He finished up, and he begun it. He went to Washington to win a fight and won it. Li'l Abner's seen his duty and he's done it.
You to know that we are all very proud of you. And we also want to thank you for saving our town.
Weren't hardly nothing.
Hey, how's our guinea pig husband? husband's doing up there in Washington?
Just fine. They're all turning to handsome, good-looking men.
Good-looking as you, Abner?
Pretty close.
Well, tell us about Washington, son. Is it run by a bunch of crooks?
No, sir, Pappy. And Washington's a right pretty town. Why, everything's made out of big old white marble, and you can't hardly spit without you hitting a national shrine. Right, Sam?
I ought to know, because I let go a chaw of tobacco in a strong wind. It ricocheted around the Washington Monument, flew past old Abe Lincoln, and come to rest on Jefferson's dome.
Thank heaven it didn't hit none of the Confederacy.
Sam got a $5 fine. They got law up there that says you can't deface a national shrine.
Well, never mind about defacing no national shrine, son. Tell us about the government. All them crooks.
Well, there ain't no crooks up there, Pappy. As far as I can see, there's a very nice mess of people. And I can tell you all this much, the country's doing just fine. Right, Sam?
You is so right, boy.
Them city folks and weans are pretty much alike.
Though they ain't used to living in the sticks.
We don't like stoner cement.
But we is in agreement.
When we gets down to talking politics, the country's in the very best of hands. The best of hands. The best of hands.
Treasury says the national debt is climbing to the sky.
And government expenditures have never been so high.
It makes a feller get a gleam of pride within his eye to see how our economy expands. The country's in the very best of hands. The country's in the very best of hands. The best of hands. The best of hands.
Farm bill should be 89% of parity.
Another fella recommends it should be 93.
But 80-95%, who cares about degree? It's parity that no one understands. The country's in the very best of hands.
Us voters is connected to the nominee. The nominee's connected to the treasury. When he ain't connected to the treasury, he sits around in his thigh bones. They sits around in this place they got, this big congressional parking lot. Just sits around in there, you know what? Up there they calls in their thigh bones. Them bones gonna rise again, gonna exercise the franchise again, gonna tax us up to our eyes again. When it gets them off in their thigh bones.
The country's in the very best of hands. The best of hands. The best of hands.
Them GOPs and Democrats each hates the other one.
They's always criticizing how the country should be run.
But neither tells the public what the other's gone and done. As long as no one knows where no one stands.
The country's in the very best of hands.
The money that they taxes us, that's known as revenues.
They compounds the collateral, subtracts the residues.
Don't worry about the principal and interest that accrues. They're shipping all that stuff to foreign lands.
The country's in the very best of hands.
He's very happy to have you back for Sadie Hawkins Day. Now, I'd like to remind all the rest of you folks, the race starts at 2 o'clock. So if you got any readying up to do, you better get to doing it.
Ladies, ladies, get your Sadie Hawkins Day specials. Ride chair, ropes, bear traps, running shoes. Come on, get your cotton picking hands off me.
Mammy, how come Daisy didn't come down to meet me?
Maybe she don't want no part of you, son. Then again, maybe she does.
Hi, Daisy.
Hi, Abner. Welcome home.
I sure missed you, Daisy.
Sure missed you too, Abner.
I'm sure glad I got back in time for the race this afternoon.
Sure you still want to go through with it, Abner?
Well, show them. Show.
Well, as you figured out how I'm going to catch you, I mean, so it won't be too embarrassing to your masculine pride, and so we both knows what we's doing?
Well, not exactly.
I has.
You has?
Yes, I has. Now just close your attractive eyes and see if you can't visualize it. There we is at the starting line. The mayor shoots off his gun and you takes off with your usual burst of brilliant speed.
Naturally.
I hightails it right after you.
I sees it.
You heads out for Repulsive Rock.
I gotcha.
Now I takes a shortcut over Hog Fat Boulevard.
I likes it.
You sees me coming, so you ducks down through Sowbelly Lane.
I ducks.
Now I'm gaining on you. We's heading for the promised land.
Goose Grease Gulch.
Right.
I sees it now. As my feet start slipping and sliding on them goose feathers, you start skating.
Start
you only
a
couple feet behind.
Couple
you reaches
feet.
Out your hand. You spread your fingers to grab me.
And then,
I'm sorry, Daisy.
What happened?
I puts on a and bursts of speed and dashes out of sight.
You mean you still ain't gonna let me catch you?
Well, I don't know, Daisy. I sure intended to, but now I just don't know.
Abner Yoakum?
But I know this much. I'm gonna get in that race this afternoon, and I'm gonna do my darndest to let you catch me. And I want you to know that no matter what happens, I wishes you the best of luck. Because if anybody deserves me, you do.
What you got there, Bill?
I want one of them bats.
Baseball bats.
Give me a man.
Running shoes.
That's
it. Buy now, pay now.
I'm gonna get me a bear trap.
I'll give you a change next week.
Available? Oh, available.
Well, howdy, Daisy May. What is on your scintillating and well-built little mind?
Available? I was just wondering if you could fix the... arrange to make the Sadie Hawkins Day race come out right.
So that you catches Li'l Abner.
Naturally.
Daisy May scrag. Does you realize what you're asking? That I betray my neighbor, sell out my fellow man. Now, what is there in this whole world makes you think that I could sink to such slimy depths of moral depravity and human degradation?
50 cents.
Could you make that a dollar?
Maybe could.
You has a deal. Abner will be stopped in that race today by the only diabolical device in creation fully guaranteed to freeze a fear-crazed bachelor in full flight.
Namely?
Stupefying Jones. Deal?
Deal.
All right, dearie. Shake. Not you, her.
Remember, I'm depending on you.
Your money's in the best of hands. Move it along, honey.
Available! 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 There's our man now. Howdy, available!
Howdy, Senator.
Available? Is you available?
Us all is available.
Come right on over here and meet the Honorable General Bull Moose.
Well, welcome to Dog Patch General. I'd say, what's your pleasure, sir, but I see you done brought it with you.
Jones, we've got to stop Abner Yoakum dead in his tracks this afternoon so that a passion out of here can catch him.
Naturally. And there's only one man for the job, a refugee from justice who's hiding out in these hills, a man whose name comprises the three foulest words in the English language, namely, Evil Eye Flegal.
Evil Eye Flegal? What's he like?
Picture the warm friendliness of a rattlesnake. Picture 5'4" of menacing manhood. Picture a hat covering a face of sinister rapacity. Picture two eyes peering out with supernatural powers and malevolent intent.
Someone call me.
Sashay on over here and meet the general.
Evil Eye Flegal at your service.
You actually paralyzed with your eyes?
It is known in paralyzing circles as Flegal's famous fabulous fracturizing whammy.
Can you put that whammy in Abner Yoakum long enough for Miss Von Climax to catch him?
Naturally. Get the picture. Sadie Hawkins' day begins. The gun goes off. Bachelor's running, maiden's pursuing. Yoakum comes dashing by. I jumps up and down, rotates my eyeballs, rears back, and lets fly a triple whammy, which hits the fleeing Yoakum smack in the back.
And then?
His bone marrow freezes. His pancreas petrifies. All his red corpuscles, white corpuscles suddenly stand stock still and stupidly stare at each other. Whereupon, who dashes up and claims the body but this superbly stacked young lady?
Is he dead?
With Yoakum, you can't always tell.
Will you guarantee he'll thaw out?
Absolutely.
Flegel, you deliver Yoakum, and you've got a job with me for life.
At your service.
I've got confidence in that little fella. He's the same color as money. All right, you miserable, fear-crazed bachelors. When I shoots off this gun, you will disperse backside over tea kettle in all directions. When I shoots this gun off the second time, this bevy of love-starved, Valentine-believing maidens will take after you. Now, there are no rules. Remember, everything goes. Bachelors ready?
Yeah.
Maidens ready?
Yeah.
Sadie Hawkins Day is officially... Not yet. Get back in your position, boy. All right, then. Sadie Hawkins Day is officially begun. Oh!
Washington, D.C. While the world continues to await the final outcome of the tests of the miraculous Yoakumberry Tonic, the hearts of America have gone out to Abner Yoakum and a passionate Avon Climax in what is to be truly the marriage of the century. This spectacular event will take place at the estate of General Bulmus on Tuesday next.
Daisy?
Oh, hello, Sam.
I knows how you feels, Daisy. I misses him, too.
It ain't just missing him, Sam. All day I's had this cold, shuddery kind of feeling. I just knows little Abner's in some kind of real mortal danger.
What makes you so sure?
I always gets this terrible feeling when Abner's in trouble. It's a clutching, grabbing feeling right in here. You know what I mean, Sam?
Of course I do, honey. But when I gets that feeling, it's either a mite of gas, the approach of a creditor, or I button the wrong button on my drawers.
Oh, I'm so miserable, Sam.
Well, if you really feels that Abner's in mortal trouble, go see Mammy and have her conjure up one of her visions. You know she's got the mystical power to see if her boy's in trouble.
I did ask Mammy to conjure. She's up at the cabin right now making the preparations. But I don't know whether she can conjure all the way up to Washington.
Oh, don't you worry about Mammy. She'll conjure all right. Wait a minute. Where you all going?
We's leaving for Washington to pick up our newly beautified husband.
Yeah, the government said it was okay.
Oh, wait, and what you all carrying there?
We just bought these from Available Jones. It's a special happiness guarantee on your second honeymoon do-it-yourself kit.
Well, let's see what's in them.
A black lace nightie, some sweet-smelling perfume,
and that new romantic album, Music to Scratch Your Back By.
That ought to do the job.
Moonbeam, when you get up to Washington, would you tell little Abner hello for me if you sees him, please?
I sure will, Daisy.
Well, we better get on down to the station or we'll miss our train.
Yeah, I think
bye,
so.
Bye, Sam.
Bye, bye, Daisy.
Bye. Bye now.
I could just cry. Everybody's so in love.
Now, now, everything's going to be just fine for you.
No, Sam, how could it be? Well, who'd want to marry me now? I've waited around so long, I'm plumb wasted away.
That may be, honey. But what you got left over is more than what most folks starts out with.
No, Sam. I looked in the mirror this morning, and there's no doubt about it, my good years is gone.
I guess you're right. After all, you is pushing 18.
I'm past my prime.
What a shame.
And I'm losing time.
Guess the old clock's run down.
17 last spring.
My, what a wasted life.
Still without a ring.
Would you become my wife?
I'm past my peak.
Use an early antique.
Look at this physique.
Just hear the old bones creak.
Where there was a glow,
ain't there a glow no more?
Now the wrinkles show.
Where about Romeo?
Who'd think of marrying an octogenarian, an 87-year-old hag? When using this position, you lose your disposition.
All the time it's nag, nag, nag.
Life's like a song,
and the happiest thing
when you're young and strong.
Most every day is spring,
but it's just a crime.
You can't get off the dime
when you're past your prime.
Use past your prime.
Getting grumpy and gray.
Use on overtime.
Ain't making take-home pay.
Every sum that sets.
All through the day our frets.
Brings you more regrets.
And larger silhouettes.
Use climb the heights.
I is over the hill.
Of romantic nights.
My hand has lost its skill.
Comes the cruel dawn.
I's feeling pale and drawn.
Lover boy has gone.
Doggone. Oh. I ask you, who's the lady? underground. When you is antiquated, boys ain't enchantiquated. They prefers you in the round. Life's just like pie.
Huckleberry or peach.
When you're young. And
heaven's within your reach,
but it's just to cry.
How can it be sublime
when you're past your prime? When you're past your prime, when you're past your
sounds of the supernatural. Ah, Pansy Oakum craves your indulgence while I conjures up a vision of my boy Washington, D.C. Beaks of owls and reptiles, gizzards, claws of bats and tongues of lizards, eels and snakes and other vipers, also bugs on windshield wipers, cauldron hiss and cauldron bubble. Tell me if my boy's in trouble.
Yes, Doctor. Disastrous news, General. For international reasons, the government has ordered that the Yokumberry tests be completed by tomorrow midnight.
Tomorrow midnight?
Yes, sir.
That means I've got to move fast. Stay where you are, Doctor. You'll hear from me.
How do you like that? They've moved up the deadline on those tests to tomorrow midnight.
No!
That means that Yokum will be giving his drug to the government before he's married to a passionata.
I'll be dogged.
Well, by Simmons mattress and all his springs, I'm not taking this lying down.
What'll you do, Wolsey?
If I can't get the rights to Yokumberry tonic, I'll at least get Yokum to tell me the secret formula so I can make the stuff myself. And there's only one man for the job. Press my evil eye Flegel button.
You sent for me, boss?
A Flegel? I only have until midnight tomorrow to get a secret formula out of Yokum. Now, have you got a whammy that can make a man tell the absolute truth?
Naturally. It's known as Flegel's famous non-prevaricating, veracitizing truth whammy.
Good.
Now, what would you like on that whammy? The truth, the whole truth, a half truth, or a little of each?
You mean you got a whammy that'll make a man tell half the truth?
Certainly. Among used car dealers, it's one of my biggest items.
But, Boozy, what happens to Yokum after you get the formula?
We proceed with Flegel's original plan.
Right. I gives him my suicidal sports car whammy. He jumps into some handy convertible and drives himself off the nearest cliff.
Capital! Veracitize him at once.
Okay, who gets him loaded?
Loaded?
This truth whammy only works when a victim is gassed, pickled, under the influence of alcohol.
But, Bullsey, you know Abner doesn't drink.
Why not?
He says he's 100% red-blooded American, and no 100% red-blooded American drinks, smokes, tells naughty jokes, necks, pets, or smooches.
Then who gave this country a population of 160 million?
Some oversex subversives.
There must be some way to get that boy to take a drink.
What about the society party you're giving us tomorrow night?
Ho-ho, we got him. No 100% red-blooded American would dare refuse to drink a toast to his prospective bride. Champagne, all right?
Champagne's perfect.
Good, then proceed as planned. Right, boys?
Right. He calls the shots and he expects to keep it that away. What's good for General Bull Moose is good for the USA.
Baby,
baby,
baby, what is it? What did you see?
Oh,
Oh, you was right, child. You was right. He is in terrible mortal danger. They means to kill him.
Who does?
General Bull Moose. I seen the whole miserable plan. They means to nuptialize him, veracitize him, suicide him.
Suicide him?
We gotta do something.
We gotta act fast.
We gotta get up to Washington.
Daisy, I desire words with you.
This sharp earthquake.
I loves you, gal.
Not now, earthquake. There must be some way we can get help.
How are we ever going to defeat a strong force like General Bull Moose? We don't have any power.
That's right. Nobody's strong enough to... Earthquake. Hmm? Li'l Abner's in terrible trouble up to Washington. Maybe get killed if we don't help him.
Yeah, that's a crying shame. Now, Daisy, honey, if you marry me, I'll do anything
for
you.
All right, Earthquake, I will.
You will?
Daisy!
What you saying?
On one condition.
What's that?
That you comes up to Washington and you uses your brute strength to help save Li'l Abner's life.
And if and I does, you solemn promises to give yourself to me?
Our solemn promises to give myself to you.
Body and soul?
Body and soul.
One at a time or both together?
You takes your pick.
Lady, you just got yourself a passport to ecstasy.
Not now, Earthquake. We ain't got time.
We're gonna need help. You get those ornery scrags and anybody else that can scrap and tell them to bring their socializing clothes.
As soup and fish?
That's right, because we's heading for high society country. And when we gets there, there ain't gonna be anybody soupier or fishier than we are.
Daisy, what you doing here?
I sneaked in, Abner. I had to come to warn you to run away for your life.
What are you talking about?
You're in terrible mortal danger. You dasn't marry Mr. Passionetta.
Daisy, how can you say such a terrible thing? You know as we lives by the coat of the hills, and she won me fair and square.
But Abner...
Besides, Mr. Passionetta's been pining to marry me, and I ain't about to break no more hearts than already has.
But they's aiming to kill you.
Who is?
That General Bull Moose and your precious intended.
Daisy, how can you say such a terrible thing?
It's true. They aims to nuptialize you, veracitize you, and suicide you.
Daisy, I'm starting to get angry. You's making this up out of your head because you're a poor guy who's still miserably in love with me. For which I can't blame you because I could see how it could happen.
Oh. Abner Yoakum, you run for your life.
Daisy, you go on home and forget all about me.
No, Abner.
Get out of here. That's an order.
No, Abner.
Get. I hear spoken.
Thank you.
there'll be bloodshed.
How about that?
Now, all of you, out!
Don't hurt them. They're my kinfolk. Mammy and Pappy, you should not have done this. After all, I give my word.
Start moving.
Earthquake, do something.
That's right, Earthquake, do something. Do something like you promised. You and your big mouth back in Dog Patch.
Now, all of you out.
Just a minute, everybody. Wait up. General Boomu, sir.
We sorry we caused this disturbance, but we was under the impression you aimed to harm our good friend Abner, who we loves and adores.
Preposterous.
But we was wrong, so we'll go in quiet like.
Why, you miserable double-crossing
snake in the grass.
Earthquake, you's a gentleman.
Thank you, Abner. But I'd sure like us all to part friends. So I'm asking you, Brother Bull Moose, to let us all join you in drinking a toast to Abner, the future Mrs. Yoakum.
You no good miserable.
Well, I'm not one to harbor a grudge. Waiter, champagne.
I told you he was real friendly, like.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, a toast to the lovely young bride-to-be. May the flower of her sweet innocence burst into blossom and bring joy to this fine young man. I give you that sterling example of red-blooded American manhood, Abner Yoakum.
There you is, a ricochet truth whammified Mr. Boom Boos.
Earthquake, you little rat, we got it.
Now he's got to tell the truth.
Mr. Policeman, just you listen. General Bull Moose, is you or is you not a no good dirty double crossing finagling crook?
Would you repeat the question?
Is you or is you not a no good dirty double crossing finagling crook?
Yes, madam, I am.
And just what did you intend doing with Abner Yoakum?
Subjecting to Evil Eye Flegel's truth whammy.
So he'd tell you
the secret formula of Yoakumberry tonic?
Whereupon you intended to
further use the nefarious E.E. Flegel?
The purpose being
put a suicidal whammy on the gullible Yoakum?
Whereupon a poor fool would
jump into my fastest sports car
and subsequently
drive himself over the nearest cliff,
making it appear like
accidental death,
when for real and true it was
cold-blooded premeditated murder.
There you has it, a confessed murderer. Take him away!
But Boosie! Boosie!
Attention, everyone! All residents of Dog Patch are hereby ordered to return home immediately and resume their orderly evacuation.
Are you crazy, man?
The evacuation and the bombing will be concluded tomorrow.
But, Mr. Army Man, what about our Yoakumberry tonic?
I'm sorry. The tests have been declared a total failure. Now attention, all you women whose husbands have been used as guinea pigs. A special bus will take you to the laboratory immediately. Owen Yoakum, I'm afraid you'll have to come along with them.
Yes, sir.
What about our newly beautified husbands?
Is they all right?
You'll find out at the laboratory. This way, Yoakum.
Hello, lady.
Wait a minute. I earned you fair and square. You coming with me.
Please, Earthquake, not till I find out what happens to Li'l Abner. Please, Earthquake, dear.
But remember, you mine now, forever and forever.
Yes, Earthquake, forever and forever.
Where's our husband?
What's gone wrong?
Is they in trouble?
Oh, is they hurt?
Ladies, quiet, please. In one moment, you will see for yourselves. Just step over here. All right, let the subjects enter.
Is they our husbands? They is beautiful. Look at all their muscles. They's gorgeous. They ain't nothing wrong with them.
That I like things.
Madam, would you embrace your husband?
Oh, boy, would I. Lake.
Ladies, with the rest of you, embrace your husbands.
Luke! Clem! Hey! Ruth! Sy!
Hey! What's wrong with them?
They don't care about us no more?
Li
Ladies, I'm afraid these tests have tragically demonstrated that while Yoakum Berry Tonic will make men physically perfect, eternally youthful, and incredibly attractive, they unfortunately lose all romantic interest.
Good gosh, they've all become Li'l Abners.
Precisely.
What's we gonna do now?
It's inhuman.
You can't leave them like that.
You just can't.
Put them back the way they was. Oh, put them back the way they was. They was dumb, they was heathen, but at least they was breathing, so whatever.
Waiting outside to take you back to Dog Patch.
But Mr. Army Man, what is we gonna do?
Return to Dog Patch and proceed with the evacuation.
But what about our husbands?
They must remain here. Now, please, move on.
Oh, you can't leave them like that.
Please, please. I'm afraid you folks will have to come along, too.
We'll move along directly. If I hadn't seen it with my own eyes, wouldn't have believed it.
Mr. Scientist, is they the way they is and Abner the way he is because he's been taking Yoakum Berry Tonic all his life?
Regretfully true, Miss Scragg.
Oh, that no good, miserable tree.
The bus is waiting. Do they all go?
All except these men and Mr. Yoakum. We'll need you for further study.
Yes, sir.
All right, men. Out this way, please.
Come along, folks.
Well, Daisy, I guess this is goodbye for a while.
It's goodbye forever, Abner.
Forever? Why?
Because I promised Earthquake that if he'd come up to Washington and use his brute strength to help save your life, that him and me'd get married. Well, he did, and we's gonna.
Earthquake, Could I have one moment alone with Daisy? Before she leaves?
Well...
Please, Earthquake.
No messing around.
No messing around. Oh, Abner, I'm so miserable I could die.
I knows how you feels, Daisy, but we lives by the coat of the hills and a promise is a promise.
Maybe there's something we could do.
It's too late now, but don't you worry none. Earthquake is bound to be a good man once he's married up with you.
Ain't never gonna be like it could have been with you.
I know, Daisy. I know.
Oh, Abner.
I wish it could be otherwise. Otherwise, I'm sorry we met at all. Sorry we ever had to start with those wonderful dreams you broke. broke my heart with. I wish there was some other way, like it is, our backs is against the wall. Just seems that fate put this heart of mine under some engine sign, or otherwise you'd still be mine, all mine, or otherwise you'd still.
Daisy.
I done it. Was all my fault. I ruined my own boy.
Mammy, I got something to say.
Hesh, I never should have given Abner that tonic. I should have known
now,
from the
Mammy,
start.
Now, Mammy, I'm going to be heard.
I said, Hesh, why didn't I have more sense? Why didn't I realize
out of all... You're going to listen to me?
Would you hesh up, you little pipsqueak?
You hesh up.
What?
For once, you going to hesh and stay heshed. I got some private talking to do with my boy. And by gum, I'm going to do it.
But, Pappy, I was only going to try to...
Now, you get, woman. Get? Get? I'll see you when I get back in Dog Patch. If an eye takes a notion to.
But, Pappy, I...
Get? I has spoken. Boys, come in here. Boys, come here. I want you to listen to this and listen careful, because I think I got a way how to get you out of your miserable condition.
Well, what is it?
A special potion developed by our beloved founder, Jubilation T. Cornpone.
Oh, Pappy, we've taken enough tonics and potions already.
Yes, but you haven't taken Cornpone's powerfully potent, perpetually passionizing and romanticizing potion.
Pappy... Could that potion romanticize me and put these boys back the way they was?
Well, son, all I can tell you is that when I was your age, I had a mightier trouble myself. So I took me a little swig of that potion.
And what happened?
As I wiped my lips, your sweet, ugly little mammy come a-walking by. And I can only tell you that that dried up, sawed-off little creature looked to me like Lillian Russell, Gloria Swanson, and a plate of pork chops rolled into one.
Well, what are we waiting for? Come on.
Yeah, just a minute. There's one mighty special and important condition that goes with this potion. You see, it only works if you really want it to work.
Oh, I does, Pappy. More than anything else in the whole world.
Well, then get it going. That wedding ain't waiting for man or beast, and with earthquakes, that covers both ends.
Right, come on.
Western Union, please. I wants to send a telegram to Marion Sam, Dog Patch, USA. Message? Well, just three words. Stall, stall, stall.
All right, Sam, we only got 20 minutes, so start festivitating the festivities.
Earthquake, why don't you wait till he's relocated?
No, sir. With all this shuffling around, the queen liable to shuffle herself right out in the deck. Right, Cousin Romeo?
You're so right, Cousin Magoon.
So start festivitating.
Very well. Dearly beloved, We is gathered here today. Earthquake, I can't do it.
Can't do what?
I can't shortchange you. You want an $8 wedding, I gotta get into an $8 mood, and there's no way of knowing how long it's gonna take me to get there. I'm there. Dearly beloved. Dearly beloved. Dearly beloved. Dearly beloved!
Come on, Sam, we ain't got much time. So hurry up and get down to the odd dozens.
Well, that's right, Sam. Proceed. Only I do wish, Earthy dear, that you'd wait till all the rest of my kinfolk get here. Carol, this wedding is gonna mean so much to them.
Why, of course, my dear.
With the bombing and all, they just can't wait to get into their nice new home.
Naturally.
With their new rich relative.
Most assuredly, my... Rich relative? Who?
Why, you, of course.
Me?
You don't think a scrag would let another scrag go homeless, long as they was related to anyone as well-heeled as the world's dirtiest wrestler.
You mean you want these three miserable scrags to come and live with us?
Why, of course.
You is a first-class provider, Cousin Magoon.
The others will be along directly.
Others?
I sent Speedy McRabbit out to tell them all the good news. I knew you'd want it that way, Earthy dear.
Well, no, I never counted on it.
Say, look who's here.
Why, it's Uncle Unbearable Scrag and his three darling children. Unthinkable, unwashable, and unhuman. Say hello to your new rich relative.
Hi, Cousin Andy.
Thanks for the invite.
When do we eat?
Hi, Cousin.
Why, look who come out of the swamp. It's on appetizer, Scrag and his two dazzling daughters, priceless and liceless.
Welcome to the family, Cousin.
The show is generous.
Hi, Cousin Earthy.
Well, upon my soul, it's the Bar Harbor Scrags.
Yeah, they've been barred from every harbor in the country.
Children will be here in the morning.
What time is you serving dinner?
Well, Sam, ain't you got some marrying to do?
I sure has. Well, batten down your hatches and grab hold of each other while I let's fly with my $8 wedding. Dearly beloved, we is gathered here today.
You got to dearly beloved.
To put an unfortunate, miserable critter away.
There he was hung first.
Remember poor Adam who got married and so began that miserable race of creatures known as the married man.
Married man.
Then think about Samson who was Israel's strongest male.
The strongest.
Till little Delilah went and give him a ponytail.
Ponytail.
State your objections or forever hold your peace.
He's telling you state your objections.
You sign on a genuine ironclad permanent lease.
Never no escape clause.
Don't let me influence you in saying those fatal words.
Fatal words.
Just let me remind you, getting married is for the birds.
For the birds.
Now, if you still want this little gal as your lawful mate, by powers invested, I pronounce you man and...
Wait, hold on there. Hold it, Sam, stop the wedding. That's right, stop the wedding.
Did you say this is a stop the wedding?
That's what I might claim Daisy made for myself. You'll laugh out of the other side of your faces when Pappy gets here with his corn pones passionizing and romanticizing potion.
There ain't no such potion.
Oh, yes, there is.
Now, wait a minute. Maybe there is and maybe there isn't, but I gotta say something. This here lovely young gal's been in love with this fine boy all her life. And even if it means giving up my passport to ecstasy and giving up all these fine family ties, I'm willing to make the sacrifice.
Hold on, what about our passport? Besides, there ain't no such potion.
Oh, yes, there is. I've got it. Here it is, son.
Thanks, Pappy.
Now, remember, son, it only works if you really and truly want it to work.
Oh, I does, Pappy. I sure does.
What's in that jug, Pappy?
Just a little old creek water, Mammy. Just some plain old creek water.
Daisy.
Oh, Abner.
Li'l Abner, the
does you take Daisy May for your wife?
I does.
And Daisy, as you agreed,
I reckon I always was.
And now with my blessings, I pronounces you.
Wait! Look who's here! Our big oversized husbands! Pappy, give me that jug!
Hold them back! The way they was! Obey in fact the way they was! They's uncouth and unpleasant, but at least they is present doing things that we prefer! Welcome back! The way you was!
And now with my blessings I pronounce is you!
Wait! Stop the wedding! Your time is up.
But I'm almost done.
But the plane and the bomb are on their way.
But I got just three more words.
Not a word, not a syllable.
Three itty-bitty words.
Out, do you hear me? Out, on your way.
We're not leaving without our statue of jubilation. Right, Mayor Dog?
You're right. Let's go get our statue.
Yes, come on. Let's get our statue. Take it easy now. Go ahead. Fell out of the statue. Hey, look! There's some writing here signed Abraham Lincoln.
There are trucks waiting.
Abraham Lincoln? Yeah, just listen to this. Because of his lack of strategy, his military blunders, and his general ineptness, which almost single-handedly enabled the North to win this Civil War, a grateful government dedicates this statue of General Jubilation T. Cornpone, proclaiming it a national shrine.
Good heavens! It's a national shrine!
And you can't deface a national shrine.
Huh?
You can't deface it, you can't move it, and you can't bomb it.
You're absolutely right. Stop that plane. Notify Washington. Citizens of Dogpatch, the evacuation is ended.
Yay! And now with my blessings, I pronounce is you. Wait!
Why?
This joyful event can't be consummated until we pay homage to the one man who made all this possible. Who romanticized this boy? Who put them back the way they was? And who saved our town from being bombed? None other than that beloved man is setting up there on that even more beloved horse, Jubilation T. Cornpone. First in war, first in peace, first to holler, I quit.
All in one, Jubilation T. Cornpone.